Our message this evening is a question, and it's entitled DNA Paternity Testing. Who is your father? DNA Paternity Testing. Who is your what? Your father. You know, paternity testing is very important. I read a story in a Ugandan newspaper. Someday I had gone to pass by there in Kampala, and there was a family problem. The old man in the family married a certain young lady at the end of his life. And he had a child with this lady. But the rest of the family believed that this man was too old and that guy is not the son. And so when the man died, the old man died, they decided to distribute property. And the young man said, please count me in, I'm the last born of that man. And the rest of the family said, no way, all of us know that by the time our father was marrying your mother, he was not even able to have children. So you are not the son. The matter ended up in court, and a DNA test was ordered. And according to that newspaper, in this family, the true son, the only child of that old man, was this young child. DNA paternity testing determines whether the father and the child have a relationship. Maternity, on the other hand, maternity testing proves whether mother and child have a relationship. DNA paternity testing, the question is, who is your father? This DNA testing, by the way, for those who don't know what DNA is, it's deoxyribonucleic acid. Are we together? And I can say this without looking at my notes. Are we together? While going through this great university, I did anatomy and physiology as a course. Are we together? Yeah, that money was not wasted. You don't say, what is a theologian pursuing in biology? There are so many reasons. These liberal arts, are we together? So I had good time learning math, Kiswahili, and all those things, tractor driving and what have you. All of it has helped me in life. You wait, it will help you. Are we together? Yeah. Deoxyribonucleic acid, profiling, genetic fingerprinting. And you know the father of genetics is Gregor Mendel, isn't it? Are we together? You know that. I mean, that's common knowledge. Are we together? Yeah. DNA testing is currently the most advanced and accurate technology in determining parentage. You can share a name. You can call yourself by my name, but I will not become your father. Just sharing a name is not enough. You can even share clothes designs. All of us wear the same design of clothes. We can even have the same characteristics, and everybody imagine that must be the father, that must be the son, that must be the daughter. But that does not establish a relationship. DNA establishes the relationship because it is the building block, the blueprint, the foundation of a person, the philosophy of who we become as translated to us. I would have told you more about chromosomes. Are we together? 23, and you know those kind of things. But I don't want to trouble your mind with academic stuff. Are we together? And so we are saying DNA paternity testing. Who is your father? All religious organizations claim to be directly related to God. All religious organizations, all of them claim to be directly related to God. All Christian denominations claim to follow Christ and have God as their father. All of them. They say, actually, God and us are one. Leave alone these other denominations. It is us and God. We are just one. These claims need solid verification through DNA paternity testing. Too many people claiming, God is my father. My father, I'm telling you, what I'm doing is exactly what the Bible says. We need DNA paternity testing of a scriptural context. The question is, all these people claiming that God is their father, are they really related to the God of the Bible? Is there a relationship, or are they masquerading as children when they are not children? And that's why this evening we are talking of DNA paternity testing. Who is your father? You need to verify. Now, time for all lies to be set aside. That Ugandan family where a bunch of people were, I wish they were humble enough to have invited that young man and say, okay, let's share well. The secret will not have been known. But I wonder what happened after that, because the young man must have told them, now you step outside as I discuss with my mother whether you can get anything in this estate. DNA paternity testing. Who is your father? Let's look at family history. Every family has history. Are we together? Family history, Revelation chapter 12. Let's look quickly at family history in Revelation chapter 12. What did I say we are looking at? Family history. So that we determine whether this is really your father, or you've been calling somebody your father who you have no relationship whatsoever. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 12, we will attempt to read the entire chapter. We will attempt. A great and wondrous sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and a crown of 12 stars on her head. Now, let me interpret this stuff, because biblical prophecy has interpretation, it's symbolic. When the Bible talks of a woman, it represents the church of God. If the woman is good, is the good church. If the woman is bad, is the false church. And here we find a woman clothed with the sun, the righteousness of Jesus Christ that is in the church. With the moon under her feet, the moon gets its light from the sun, and therefore the moon represents the word of God. And a crown of 12 stars. These are the 12 leaders that we see in the Old Testament, tribes of Israel, and in the New Testament, the disciples of Jesus Christ. Verse 2. She was pregnant and cried out in pain as she was about to give birth. This woman, the church, is about to give birth. The old time church. Verse 3. Then another sign appeared in heaven, another one different from this one. An enormous red dragon with the 7 heads and the 10 horns and 7 crowns on his head. Now, when you read verse 9, it quickly tells you that this dragon is Satan. So the church is here, expectant, ready to give birth. And there is Satan next to the church. Let's continue reading. And the Bible says, verse 4, his tail, that is the tail of the dragon, that is Satan, swept a third of the stars out of the sky and flung them to the earth. The dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth so that he might devour her child the moment it was born. Aha. This devil, we are told, who is the dragon, swept a third of the stars from the sky. And we know that when the devil began his activities in heaven, he persuaded a third of the angels to follow him. A third of the stars. And he is ready to swallow whatever child this woman will give birth to. Let's continue. Verse 5. She gave birth to a son, a male child, who will rule all the nations with an iron scepter. And her child was snatched up to God and to his throne. She gave birth to a child that will rule the nations with an iron scepter. Revelation 19 tells us that the child who will rule with an iron scepter is Jesus Christ. And we are told that this child was snatched up to heaven. And so, after Jesus Christ was born in the church at that time, he was born through Mary in that religious organization. He lived for 33 years. And after that, he ascended back to heaven. He was snatched up to heaven, and the devil could not defeat Jesus Christ. Verse 6. The woman fled into the desert to a place prepared for her by God, where she might be taken care of for 1,260 days. Prophetically, a day stands for a year, 1,260 years. The church had now to hide in the wilderness for this many years because the government of the time, which was Papal Rome, was against the true church of God. What follows in verse 7 is the origin of Satan. All the way verse 7 to 12, it talks about the origin of Satan, his fight in heaven, his being dismissed from heaven and coming down on earth. We fast forward to verse 13. In verse 13, we are told, when the dragon saw that he had been hurled to the earth, he pursued the woman who had given birth to the male child. When Satan realized, the Bible says, when Satan realized that he had been hurled on earth from heaven, he pursued the church. What is the Bible saying? Satan does not look for his people who are already on his side. Satan is looking for people who belong to God. And so, when you belong to God, you are tempted, you are tried, you are frustrated. Why? Because Satan is after those who are in the church. He is not after those who are already on his side. That's why several times in Scripture, Jeremiah and even David in the book of Psalms tells us that, look at the wicked prospering. Why do the wicked prosper? Because the devil is not against them. But he says, don't worry, it will be for a short while. And so, the dragon is against the church. The church, remember, verse 14. The woman was given two wings of a great eagle so that she might fly to a place, prepared for her in the desert, where she will be taken care of for a time, times and half a time, out of the serpent's reach. That is the same period of 1260 days. Then from the mouth of the serpent spewed water like a river to overtake the woman and sweep her away with the torrent. And many false teachings came to drown the church, but the church is not drowned. Many philosophies came to drown the church, but the church was not drowned. Let's continue. Let's read verse 17. Okay, verse 16 says, but the earth helped the woman by opening up its mouth and swallowing the river that the dragon had spewed out of its mouth. Then verse 17 says, then the dragon, that is Satan, became angry with the woman and went off to make war with the rest of her offspring. Satan got angry at the true church of God and said, now I declare war on everyone who is associated with the true church of God. And so what does the Bible say? Who are those who are associated with the true church of God? It says, those who obey God's commandments and those who hold the testimony of Jesus Christ. The DNA of the true church of God that is directly related to God is holding the commandments of God. If you claim to belong to God, but you don't hold the commandments, the paternity test shows negative. And by the way, paternity test does not come in 50%. It is either 0% or 99.99%. You either belong to the Father or you don't belong to the Father. Of course, there are a few abnormal people who are called chimeras. Are we together? Who have got confusing DNA who may give a false negative, but sometimes, you know, that has to be double tested so that you get... Are you getting what I'm talking about, or I should speak English? What I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, what I'm here telling you is that if we belong to God the Father, then the DNA test must clearly show that we belong to the Father. And how does it show? We must be people who keep the 10, not the 9 commandments. You cannot claim to belong to the Father when you worship idols. You cannot claim to belong to the Father when you steal, when you kill, and when you break the Sabbath and come up with your own Sabbath. This is not your Father. You need to get another Father. This one, not your Father. DNA paternity testing. Who is your Father? Have you been masquerading, calling God your Father when he's not your Father? The test is clear. If you don't keep the 10 commandments, he says, I ain't your Father. Duh. John chapter 8. Let's turn to John chapter 8 here. John chapter 8. In John chapter 8, Jesus talked about paternity, by the way. In John chapter 8, verse 42 to 45, Jesus talked about paternity. Let's read that. He says, Jesus said to them, if God were your Father, is this paternity or is not paternity? No, I'm asking you. Listen to the question. He says, if God were your Father, is this a discussion on paternity or it is not? It is. Jesus is discussing paternity. And he says, let me see. Jesus said to them, if God were your Father. So let's proceed. If God were your Father, you would love me, for I came from God and now I'm here. I have not come on my own, but he sent me. Verse 43. Why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. And verse 44, he tells them, I know your paternity. Look at verse 44 and look at it in a shy manner. Jesus tells them, you belong to your Father, the devil. The paternity test shows that you claim to be related to God, but your father is the devil. You have no relationship to the God of heaven. That is why you can't understand when I tell you what the Bible says. Jesus is telling them, I'm telling you the truth. You are not getting it. You are disputing. You keep asking questions, hoping to find what will satisfy you. And he's saying the reason is because you don't belong to this family. You've been eating around here. You've been dressing around here, but you don't belong to the family. When it comes to time of inheriting the kingdom, you're getting nothing. Because this is not your father. Tell them you belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires while in this family. He was a murderer from the beginning. He never held to the truth. For there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language. For he is a liar and the father of lies. Yet because I tell you the truth, you do not believe me. Let me tell you, brothers and sisters, anytime you have a problem with the truth, the DNA test is out. Anytime you have a problem with the truth, the test is out. Negative. 0% relationship. DNA paternity testing. Who is your father? John chapter 10. Let's read John chapter 10. Who is your father? Is the question this evening. John chapter 10, verse 14 to 16. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Then verse 15, he gets into the fatherhood business, paternity business. He says, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Then he says, verse 16, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice. and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. He says, listen, you know, in my village, there's a lot of polygamy. And before, if a man feels that he's about to die, he brings all the sheep that he had out there that he did. Now, are we together? He brings and says, dear family members, you may not have known, but I want you to know that I have other sheep who belong to this flock. We share the same DNA. And in our village, we respect that. We don't even go to the lab to test paternity. We just bring them and say, if they belong to our relatives, you are welcome. And Jesus says, listen, you guys are here. There are other family members who belong to this family of God. They are out there. They are just confused a little bit. But I will call them. I will call them. And the only DNA test that will verify that they belong to me is they will listen to my voice. The moment they listen to my voice, it is positive they belong to this Father. But the moment they are reluctant to my voice, it is negative. No relationship, 0%. You know, I was amazed at this DNA thing as I was studying it. It is either 0% or 99.99%. He says, they know me, they know my voice, they listen to my voice. And when I call them, they come. And let me tell you, people, we've been making a call here since Sunday, and the list for baptism is growing. Hallelujah. Only that in this church, we don't baptize people. You don't come today and we baptize you today. That's why we have announced baptism will be on October 29th. Because many people have come. We need to prepare them, to teach them so that they believe. We are not in a hurry to dip people in water. No. We are focused. We know what the Master says. We are not trying to please anyone but the Master. We will teach them first. All of them. And after teaching them, we will baptize them here. There is a pool here. Beautiful pool. Freshmen, don't look at this place and think there is a beautiful pool around here. You will wish you are baptized, so you better get into the list. There is a very nice pool here. And he says, they listen to my voice. And let me tell you, every day, even at the end of last evening's meeting, people are flocking to the office, and we will spend an extra hour registering God's true DNA children for baptism. That's why we are saying, DNA testing, who is your father? He says, they will come and there will be one flock. What is this business of people saying, it doesn't matter whether you go, whether you are in that church or the other one, it is okay so long as you are heading to heaven. Jesus says there will be one flock. If you are planning to have another one, it's because you have another father. But if the father is the same, there can only be one family. He says, wherever they are, I will call, and the DNA will test when they respond and come. And in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, it's a good one. Eh? Hebrews 10, 25. You should write these in bold letters in your rooms. Are we together? This is a good one. About family meetings, it says, let us not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of accumulating absences. Are we together? Hey, are we together? Let us not give up meeting together as some in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching when we are going to share family inheritance. The day is approaching when the father is going to share his inheritance. He is going to share out his wealth, and his wealth is eternal life. And he's saying, hey, if you are a true family member, you will not give up meeting. But if your DNA shows you don't belong to this father but the other father, when it's church time, you will be playing soccer. When it is church time, you will be saying, oh, I'm rushing to bed. Didn't you know church time? It has never changed. It has been the same since 1980. So So you are the variable, the church is a constant K. Do you understand that kind of mathematics? The constant K. Are we together? And the variables. It varies partly as X and partly as Y. Are we together? Don't I feel good? Matthew chapter 7. DNA paternity testing. Who is your father? Professor Rolle, was I right in that mathematics or I missed? I didn't even know what I was talking about. Now, Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 to 23. The Bible says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Not everyone who says, Daddy, Daddy, Daddy. You could be a child who was just brought through the back door and you are busy, Daddy, Daddy, and this is not your dad. Are we together? Hey, are we together? Yeah, he's saying not everyone who is saying daddy, daddy, that is the father. This could be some stranger who just came through the window. Are we together? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do the will of my father who is in heaven. Then he says, verse 22, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles? And he will say, since when was that our family characteristic? You think my family is known for miracles? You are trying to associate my family with miracles? That you are looking for a miracle? My family, you look for another family. You don't belong here. The paternity testing for God's family is not miracles. Then I will tell them plainly, he says, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. You, my child, what's the name of your mother? You are my child? You? Ha! Since when? But I've been calling you, daddy, daddy. I didn't know you were calling me. I thought you were calling somebody. Calling me? If you don't do the will of God, your DNA paternity test is negative. It is only positive when you do the will of God. We must do the will of God that is in the Bible. And so Jesus says this in John chapter 1 verse 12. John chapter 1 verse 12 and 13. John chapter 1 verse 12. We will have read 1 John chapter 3 verse 1 to 3, but just take note of it. 1 John chapter 3 verse 1 to 3. You can read that elsewhere. Let's just read John chapter 1 verse 12 and 13. The Bible says, these are the words of Jesus. Yet all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. Hallelujah. And he says, children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but children born of God. Hallelujah. The Bible says that if I receive Jesus today, my DNA changes to be the DNA of God, and he becomes my father. Not born of human will, of a husband's will, but by the will of God himself, who says, whoever accepts me becomes my child. And he says to all who received him, it does not matter their skin color. It does not matter their background. It does not matter how much money they have in the bank. And even their GPA does not matter. He says to all who received him, he gave them the right to become the children of God. So my brothers and sisters, all who receive him today will become the children of God. Do you want God to be your father? Is the question. Do you want God to be your father? If that is what you want, then you receive him today. So we are not going to waste time. We are already at the hour. We will spend 3 minutes singing softly and tenderly, God is calling for those who want to be his children. And if you want God to be your father, wherever you are, stand and come forward and say, I want my paternity test with God to be positive. You stand and come. And Dr. Alida is going to lead us in prayer this evening. Dr. Daniel Alida. So we are going to sing softly and tenderly. And as we sing, remember, it is the Father saying, you have a problem. You could be a chimera with a double DNA. Are we together? DNA of the devil and the DNA of God. And he's saying, I can fix it if you receive it. I can fix it if you receive me. Softly and tenderly. We will sing the whole song and we will pray. If anyone is there, come. And stand with God's children.
Father, we thank you so much for this evening, because we have seen that your words are powerful. It has convicted a lot of people. They have come to realize of your great love, that you are now calling us to be in one fold. We are your children. You are our Father. We thank you for this great and wonderful opportunity to be one in your church. We come before you to thank you for these many students who have come forward. They recognize that they have to surrender themselves to you. I pray that you seal their decision, Lord. Make them commit themselves to you, and they will make a grand decision to accept you as their personal Savior through baptism, and they will join us. We will all sing praises to you, great God, because you have in store for us a great reward in heaven. I pray for the rest of us, Lord, that you help us one another to stay close with you, and we will fellowship with one another in a Christian way. And I pray, Lord, that as we stay in this institution, we will all learn from each other, and we will be drawn closer to you, and we will become more faithful to you in every way, so that when you come the second time, we'll find a place in your kingdom. As we depart from this place, Lord, may your blessings be upon us. May you accept our dedication and all our requests, because we ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.